Please welcome the Editor-in-Chief of Healthcare Design, Kristen Zeit.
Good morning. I hope you're all refreshed and ready to go on this lovely Monday morning. Before we begin the Center for Health Design's awards program, sponsored by Mecco Systems, I have just a couple of brief announcements. First, there's a lot to see and do on the exhibit hall floor today. Now, if you're like me, and the only way you can get through anything is if you know where your next meal is coming from, you'll be glad to know that the exhibit hall is where you'll find today's lunch. And I also invite you to visit the Healthcare Design Solutions Theater on the show floor to hear some special presentations today. You'll find the session times in your program and on the mobile app. And don't forget about tonight's big networking event sponsored by KI. Bring your drink tickets, bring your chips, and bring your best self back here to the ballroom at 6:30 p.m., where this space will be transformed into a casino with great food, drinks, and of course, great company. And with that, it's time for the Center for Health Design Awards. Please welcome to the stage Susan Reeser, Vice President for Business Development for Mecco Systems.
Well, good morning. Good morning. And welcome to the Center for Health Design Awards program. Mecco System has been the proud sponsor of this event for many years, and we are delighted to be with you here today at Healthcare Design 2015. To quote a great philosopher of our generation, "The future's so bright, you gotta wear shades." We do shades better than anyone else. Today, we are here to honor the design teams who, this year, have done their job better than anyone else. We are here to honor a change maker who, through vision and leadership, has done his job to change the way healthcare facilities are designed and built better than anyone else. Don't let me forget the product manufacturers who rise to the challenge with award-winning healthcare products. All of us at Mecco Systems and our authorized dealer partners wish to be the first to congratulate all of this year's award winners. Now, to get this party started, it's my pleasure to introduce someone who will help us discover what's next. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Deborah Levin, President and CEO of the Center for Health Design.
Good morning, everybody. Did everybody have a great day yesterday? The Harley guy got us all riled up. He had some amazing messages. I hope everybody just had a spectacular day. So it is my pleasure to welcome you to the awards presentation. Welcome to the Center for Health Design's annual awards ceremony sponsored by Mecco System. At the Center for Health Design, we're focused on the connection between health and design. As a nonprofit organization, a passionate healthcare designers and professionals, we're dedicated to improving the quality of healthcare through design of the built environment. We started in 1993 as a team of forward thinkers with a vision for creating healthcare facilities that promote healthier environments for patients and staff. This vision became a movement. Since then, we've seen changes to healthcare facilities ranging from daylighting and access to nature to single-bed patient rooms and thoughtful design details that can reduce falls and infections. These changes are not only becoming commonplace, they're creating positive change. Today, our community is diverse. Architects, interior designers, healthcare executives, healthcare professionals, researchers, product manufacturers, educators, and students, all committed to optimizing healthcare facilities. Healthcare design is changing for the better, and we only see this trend gaining momentum. With all of you, we have helped to define the evidence-based design process for healthcare. Our staff and over 100 volunteers work hard to advance the field by certifying individuals in the evidence-based design process, creating tools and educational resources to advance EBD practice and facilitate research that links the design of the built environment to outcomes. If you want to know more, stop by our booth and meet our incredible staff and enter to win my new favorite toy, the Amazon Echo. So today we celebrate those in our industry who are supporting our mission by designing innovative products and exemplary projects that positively contribute to the quality of healthcare. But before we announce the winners, I'd like to acknowledge and thank our partners and our volunteers who commit extra time and resources to further our mission. First of all, our research partners who support the work of our research coalition and other special projects. And our 37 healthcare providers and industry partners who participate in the Pebble Project research initiative, as well as those of you who have joined the Center affiliate membership to support our research and our advance our advocacy efforts. Thank you all. Second, thanks go out to our educational partners who collaborate with us to produce conferences like this and other smaller events all throughout the year. Thank you all as well. The many volunteers who contribute thousands of hours to every year by participating in our research coalition, the EDAC Advisory Council, the Environmental Standards Council, the Knowledge Repository Advisory Board, our design juries, our editorial boards, our special projects, thank you to all of you. I'd also like to recognize the Center's Board of Directors, many of whom are here tonight, today. But last but not least, the Center for Health Design's incredible, amazing, hardworking staff who manage all of our projects and direct all of our programs. You couldn't ask for a better staff than we have. Again, please stop by our booth, meet them, and learn more about what we do. All right, now on for the awards. First up this year is a very special award that's very rarely given, the Lifetime Achievement Award. This award is given to recognize and appreciate the contribution of an individual over their entire career. Please join me in watching this short presentation highlighting this year's Lifetime Achievement Award winner, Rosalind Kama.
Known for his expertise in anticipating trends and developments in the healthcare industry, Russ Coyle was a founding board member of the Center for Health Design, a healthcare futurist, and a respected advisor to physician groups, hospitals, and health plans throughout the nation. Established in his memory, this award recognizes individuals who, like Russ, have dedicated their careers to the advancement of the healthcare design field. Rarely given, this award represents the spirit, generosity, and expertise that provide inspiration to us all. And I'm happy to present this award to my friend and mentor, Rosalind Kama. These are all words that perfectly define Roz Kama and her spirit and the light she brings to our industry. Roz not only exemplifies an industry leader, having published a well-received book on evidence-based healthcare design and a multitude of columns and articles, but she has dedicated countless hours as a volunteer to the nonprofit organizations she believes in. Presenting at various universities and conferences, Roz urges new designers to take on the unique challenges found in healthcare design and think outside the box to find innovative and dynamic new solutions. She is the recipient of many local, regional, and national design and service awards, including an honorary doctorate in fine arts from the New York School of Interior Design in 2014, and the ASID Designer Distinction Award in 2012. An advocate from the start of the evidence-based movement, Roz has worked tirelessly to help create and grow both Pebble Project and the EDAC program. A board member with the center since 1996, Roz served as the organization's board chair from 2002 to 2015. An active leader and EBD proponent, Roz has dedicated her career as an interior designer to creating environments that improve health outcomes and the healthcare experience for all those who come in contact with the environments she's helped to create. Dedicated to helping grow the baseline knowledge of healthcare design She participates as a coach each year at the Evidence-Based Design Coaching Workshop here at the conference, working one-on-one, providing personal consultation to help others integrate EBD into their projects. As president and principal interior designer of Kama Inc., Roz has been a practicing healthcare designer for 40 years and has worked on projects throughout the United States, including Yale New Haven Hospital, Bay State Health System, Dublin Methodist Hospital and Ohio Health, the American Cancer Society Hope Lodge, and the University Medical Center at Princeton. A fellow of the American Society of Interior Designers, Roz has served as the chair of its healthcare specialty network and is past national president. But she doesn't stop there. Roz has volunteered her time and her expertise tirelessly. Her leadership has propelled unprecedented growth at the Center for Health Design. She has traveled worldwide to share the vision of how design can transform healthcare environments for a healthier, safer world through research, education, and advocacy. Above all else, Roz Kama has been a mentor and a friend to me for the past 25 years. I could not imagine making this journey without her, without her humor, without her insights, and without her friendship. I know it would not have been nearly as fun or remotely as successful.
Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming to the stage my friend, my mentor, my colleague, and my partner in crime, Rosalind Kama.
Oh my God, stay standing. There's a nice Yiddish word, Deborah. It's called verklempt, I'm verklempt. I want you to stand. Do me a favor. I have two things I want you to do. Stand for me. I want you to put your hand over your heart and just feel its beat. And know that to be in this field, you have to show up with a heart that feels empathy. Now I want you to turn to a person near you and give them a hug for me. Just for being here. There. Now you all know how I'm feeling right now. They told me not to wear mascara. I didn't listen. So, I feel the true love and compassion in this room. It's why I've always given up a bit of my time. I get this feeling of connection and gratitude just for showing up to participate in this conversation about improving healthcare design. It's that simple. Not a lifetime achievement, just a blissful high. So I relate to what Ken Schmidt said on this stage yesterday. Volunteerism in the Center for Health Design has been for me a lifestyle. I've been blessed with the gifts that the unfortunate people we serve have not, the health and well-being to serve my community, and you are my community. I have been blessed with the grace of so many of you who have shared wisdom and knowledge to make a difference in the lives of those who are sick or injured. Together, we created the environments where the Hippocratic Oath to do no harm can take place. The evidence tells us that our informed designs have the power to heal those who might otherwise remain in an injurious state. So from the bottom of my empathetic heart, I thank Deborah. Oh my God, it's been a joy to work with Deborah. Our CHD staff, you folks work tirelessly. I can't thank you enough. My colleagues on the board, all of whom over the years I have looked up to, will continue to congratulate them. You know who they are. Many are here. Thank them. And my family, oh my goodness, my family, I leave them behind often. My friends, my coworkers, my colleagues in this glorious field for honoring me. So I, with tremendous respect from my heart, will savor the blessing of Russ Coyle's honorable name. So I wish you all Godspeed. Thank you. So I need to answer your burning question. And so you should know that the Center for Health Design's Board of Directors have unanimously elected Frank Weinberg. Frank, are you in the audience? Where's Frank? Here he is, Frank. As my successor and the new chair of the board of the Center for Health Design. So thank you, Frank.
And thank you.
Congratulations. You should all have an amazing partner to work with like Roz. She has just been a sheer joy for me for all of these years. So now, on with the awards. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure to welcome John Czernicki, Editor-in-Chief of Contract Design Magazine, up to present the Nightingale and Healthcare Environment Awards. John.
Good morning. Thank you, Deborah. And I just want to extend a personal congratulations to Roz. She's amazing. I was honored to serve as her editor for her book, which published about 6 years ago. So again, congratulations to Roz Kama. In Contract Magazine's partnership with the Center for Health Design, I'm so pleased to present both the Healthcare Environment Awards and the Nightingale Awards. Contract Magazine is published by Emerald Expositions, which now produces the Healthcare Design Expo and Conference. The Healthcare Environment Awards, which are co-sponsored by Contract Magazine and the Center for Health Design, in cooperation with the Healthcare Design Expo and Conference, recognize innovative, life-enhancing design that contributes to the delivery of healthcare. This year's competition identified 6 professional projects and 2 student projects as either a winner or honorable mention. This year's jurors were Tom Chesum, principal at Co-Architects, Abigail Clary, vice president and regional director of healthcare at HDR, Jane Malkin, president of Jane Malkin Inc., and Lori McGilberry, senior associate at Corrigan and president-elect of the American Academy of Healthcare Interior Designers. The winners and honorable mentions are all in the October issue of Contract Magazine, which is available here at the conference. As I call the winners to the stage, please come up to the stairs, stage left. And here are the winning projects. We'll begin by honoring the students. In the student category, an honorable mention goes to Jonathan Jiang, a student from Clemson, for his project, Foothills Family Medical Center. Jiang explores the potential for a primary ambulatory clinic within an ordinary commercial structure. Individual exam rooms are located in pods focused on different specialties, and small adjacent courtyards provide patients with access to nature. Here already is Jonathan Jiang to accept the student honorable mention. In the student category, the winner is a project named UIHC Tower 2, designed by a team of Iowa State University students, including Yongyun Cho, Heiyu Feng, Yifan Liu, and Casey Tiedman. The students proposed an undulating 12-story tower for a new hospital on the University of Iowa campus. Zones within patient rooms are designed for are designated for guest seating near the window, work areas along the periphery for healthcare staff, and a dedicated clinical space in the center for a hospital bed and medical equipment. Here to accept the award for the win in the student category are Iowa State students Yongyun Cho, Yifan Liu, and Casey Tiedman. And now the six professional projects honored as either honorable mentions or winners. In the conceptual design category, an honorable mention goes to the project Rancho Los Amigos National Rehabilitation Center in Downey, California, designed by Smith Group JJR. The firm conceived a bold new identity for Los Angeles's Rancho Los Amigos National Rehab Center on a site southeast of downtown LA. A central plaza defines the heart of the campus, and two new structures will house a variety of clinics and therapy gyms, as well as a wellness center. Here to accept the award for the project are a number of members of the team. We have Francie Moore and Pablo Lee of Smith Group JJR, Randy Regier of Taylor, and Luis Ramirez and Hassan Halak of Los Angeles County. In the long-term care category, the winner is Alden Estates of Evanston in Evanston, Illinois, designed by Alden Design Group. Alden Design Group renovated a three-story skilled nursing facility to create a comfortable residential environment. A combination of custom millwork, unique textiles, and wall mosaics form a rich palette for revamped public spaces that encourage social interaction among residents. Emulating luxury hospitality interiors, each resident room has a private bath with shower. Here to accept the award is Tamara Turo, Director of Interiors at Alden Design Group. In the ambulatory care category, an honorable mention is awarded to Angie Fowler, Adolescent and Youth Adult Cancer Institute at University Hospitals Rainbow Babies and Children's Hospital in Cleveland, designed by Stanley Beeman and Sears. This outpatient facility was established specifically for adolescent and young adult cancer patients. The design concept embraced light, nature, and color in a warm and hopeful environment. It establishes separate spaces for pediatric and young adult patients. The facility contains two treatment wings, age-appropriate lounges, a pharmacy, and a rooftop garden. Here to accept the award is Betsy Beeman of Stanley Beeman and Sears. All right, Also in the ambulatory care category, the winner is Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center in West Harrison, New York, designed by Ewing Cole with a team from Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center. The Cancer Center has a palette that suggests calm, cool dignity, and a design that instills informal relaxation, focus, and welcome distraction when needed. The building itself was built in the 1950s as an office. In a remarkable transformation, the designers implemented small courtyards, varied ceiling heights, skylights, and double height stair to bring light and depth into the varied flexible spaces. Here to accept the award are Susan Healy of Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center and Mary Frazier of Ewing Cole. In the acute care category, the jury selected two winners and no honorable mentions. One of the winners in the acute care category is Meander Medisch Centrum in Amersfoort, Netherlands, designed by Atelier Pro Architects. Atelier Pro designed a 1 million square foot hospital to place patients, visitors, and staff in spaces that encourage active engagement with the landscape. The complex is configured akin to a village, with main avenues and public squares that provide opportunities for natural light to permeate every space. All patient rooms are private, have individual bathrooms, and feature large sliding doors leading to adjacent lounge areas that each has large windows with panoramic views. No one is here from the firm Atelier Pro Architects, which is based in the Netherlands, to accept the award, but let's give the project a round of applause. Also in the acute care category, a win goes to Roberts Pavilion, floors 8 and 9 in Camden, New Jersey, designed by Ewing Cole. The firm revisited two floors at Roberts Pavilion, built in 2008. 30 private rooms were planned for each floor, serving advanced care surgery patients on the 8th floor and heart patients on the 9th floor. Individual rooms are configured to provide an environment more akin to a high-end hotel than a hospital. Private bathrooms emulate a spa with mosaic tile showers. Here to accept the award from Ewing Cole is Mary Frazier. Great. That was the last of the Healthcare Environment Awards. Congratulations to all the winners and honorable mentions. If you'd like to learn more about these projects, please look at Contract's October issue, which is here at the conference and is focused on healthcare. And a message to all the winners, for packaging for your awards, please approach the stage right after the Changemaker presentation, and my colleague Eileen McMorrow can assist you. So now, the Nightingale Awards. And here to join me to present the Nightingale Awards is Kristen Zeit, the editor-in-chief of Healthcare Design Magazine. The Nightingale Awards recognize contributions to the healthcare built environment through product design and innovation that contributes to healing. The Nightingale Product Design Awards program began in 1990 by editors of Contract and the founders of the Center for Health Design. Earlier this year, Emerald Expositions, the publisher of Contract Magazine, also became the publisher of Healthcare Design Magazine, as well as the operator and producer of this conference, the Healthcare Design Expo and Conference.
As a result, Healthcare Design Magazine is pleased to join Contract Magazine in partnership with the Center for Health Design in presenting the Nightingale Awards. One of the judging criteria for these awards, which were named for Florence Nightingale, is a product's contribution to a healing environment. Other criteria include functionality, quality and durability, aesthetics and style, pricing and innovation. The jurors are healthcare architects, interior designers, and facilities managers. To evaluate the entries, jurors go to exhibitors' booths before our show floor opens to view, touch, and when appropriate, to sit on the products and ask questions as well.
We'd like to recognize the jurors who judge the projects on Sunday. They are Adrian Boisel, Georgianne Burns, Debbie Gregory, Lisa Harriet, Kristen Hill, Janet Kobilka, Karen Maroka, Richard Sears, and Joel Trexler. Thank you to the jurors for taking the time to view the products. When we announce a winner, please remain seated. Signage will be distributed at the end of the Nightingale Awards presentation, actually after the Changemaker Award presentation. This year, 16 products receive awards in 12 product categories. And now, we'll present the awards. In architectural products category, the silver award goes to Karstens for MediRue with Isonis.
The gold award in architectural products clinical goes to Shield Casework for Canopy.
The silver award in architectural products non-clinical goes to Logisun Acoustic Network for Target V1.5.
The gold award in architectural products non-clinical goes to Amri Studio for digital donor wall at Boston Children's Hospital.
The silver award in carpet goes to Shaw Contract Group for the park.
And the gold award in carpet goes to Mannington for Entwined.
In fabrics and textiles, the gold award goes to C.F. Stinson for Ethereal plus Apex.
The silver award in flooring hard surface goes to Metroflor Corporation for Aspecta 10 LVT.
And the gold award in flooring hard surface goes to J&J Flooring Group Kinetics for Kinetics Umbra and Umbra Stripe.
The silver award in flooring resilient goes to Shannon Specialty Floors for Think Ahead.
And the gold award in flooring resilient goes to Ecor Commercial Flooring for Terrain RX.
Okay, the silver award in lighting goes to Eaton for Failsafe Sealed Encounter ENS ENC ENV.
In seating guest lounge, the silver award goes to Krug for Zola Privacy.
The gold award in seating guest lounge goes to Nemshoff for Easton Multiple Seating.
And the gold award in seating patient goes to Nemshoff for Avo Recliner.
And the silver award in signage and wayfinding goes to Vivid Board, a GMI company, for InHarmony changeable glass boards.
And now, out of all those products you saw, we will announce the one product selected by the jurors as the Best of Competition winner. The Nightingale Best of Competition winner is Nemshoff in seating patient for the Avo Recliner. We ask that Gary Crusay, Director of New Product Development for Nemtsov, come to the stage to accept the award and maybe say a few words about the product. Gary, if you're here.
Well, I'm very surprised. Thank you so much. This project started out by first trying to understand the workflow for nurses, and we spent a bit of time in hospitals, particularly with the nursing group at Frederick Medical Center in Wauwatosa, Wisconsin. It's always fun to say. But the team back at Nemtsov, the support of the Miller family, trying to put together a product that really met the end user needs was the objective and a very satisfying project for that. So thank you for the recognition and appreciate that.
Congratulations to all of the 2015 Nightingale Award recipients. Those of you who did win awards, please meet Eileen McMorrow at stage right to receive your award booth signage. Attendees can look for signage on the exhibit floor where the winning products are exhibited.
Great, and thank you, everyone. And now I turn the stage to Rosalind Kama and the rest of the Center for Health Design's awards presentation.
Thank you.
Thank you, John and Kristen, and thank you again to our award partners, Contract Magazine and Healthcare Design Magazine, and Emerald Expositions for providing complimentary registrations to the Healthcare Environment Award winners and support for the Nightingale Awards. Visit our website for more information on how to enter both of these award competitions next year. So you ready? Our final award today is the Changemaker Award. Presented each year by the Center's Board of Directors, the Changemaker Award honors individuals or organizations that have demonstrated exceptional ability to change the way healthcare facilities are designed and built, who demonstrate the ability to lead and inspire others to go beyond the status quo and the change the way we think about healthcare environments. The list of past winners reads like a who's who in our industry, accomplished individuals who have and are still making a difference in health facility design. This year's changemaker, no surprise, probably long overdue, goes to Dr. Roger Ulrich. Roger is currently guest professor of architecture at the Center for Healthcare Architecture at Chalmers University of Technology in Sweden, as well as professor emeritus of architecture at Texas A&M University. He is the most frequently cited researcher internationally in evidence-based healthcare design. Thank you. A co-founding director of the Center for Health Systems and Design at Texas A&M University, and an interdisciplinary center housed jointly in the Colleges of Architecture and Medicine. Roger also served at the invitation of Britain's National Health Service from 2005 to 2006 as senior advisor on patient care environments to create scores of new hospitals. A founding member of the Center for Health Design's board, and currently a board director emeritus, Roger's work has directed, impacted the design of billions of dollars of hospital construction and improved the health outcomes and safety of patients around the world. His recent work has dealt with subjects as varied as how design can lessen aggressive behavior in psychiatric care facilities to the negative impacts of hospital noise on patients and nurses, and how nature, gardens, and art can lessen pain, stress, and healthcare cost. Simply stated, the world has benefited from Roger's research that aligns healthcare design's impact on human operational and economical outcomes. Most notably, he was the first to document scientifically the stress-reducing and health-related benefits of viewing nature through a window or an artwork for hospital patients. Roger's dedication to applying the standards of modern medical research with strict experimental controls has helped to quantify accurately certain design interventions' impact on health outcomes, specifically those that speed the healing process. Please join me now in welcoming this year's changemaker, Roger Ulrich. And first, we'll hear reflective remarks from Roger, followed by an engaging conversation between Roger and his colleague, Kirk Hamilton. So don't take off so quickly. Roger.
I am greatly honored to be this year's recipient of the Changemaker Award. This is an important award across the wide field of healthcare design, and receiving it means a very great deal to me. I'm proud to join the distinguished list of changemakers who have all caused substantial positive changes in the way that healthcare buildings are designed and built. I think the fact that the Changemaker Award is being given to me this year is unusual, to say the least. After all, I'm trained as a researcher, an academic nerd, not as a designer or healthcare facility or manager like previous winners. I think it's a sign of the increasing role that research has in healthcare design and of the growing importance that clients place on evidence-based design. Healthcare design research has come a very long way indeed since the early years of the so-called healing environments movement in the late 80s and early 90s. At the time, there was actually very little quality research. At first glance at the time, the number of published studies ran into the tens of thousands. But on second glance, nearly all were based on conjecture, intuition, or personal experience. So the healing environments movement, at least in the initial years, was underpinned by very little real evidence. Rather, the movement and the founding of the first annual conference, large conference called then the Symposium, was fueled mainly by the widely shared conviction that hospitals and other healthcare buildings ought to be much better designed and could be much better designed. There was widely expressed criticism that hospitals were psychologically hard buildings, harsh, functional, even brutal environments, designed in ways insensitive to the emotional needs of patients. As a child, I'd been a hospital patient myself on different occasions and could not have agreed more with this critical view. In 1984, I published a research article titled "View Through a Window May Influence Recovery from Surgery." What was new about the study was that it was among the first well-controlled, rigorous studies to measure the impact of the designed healthcare environment on clinical outcomes, such as the number of pain drugs patients needed or the lengths of their stays. The article, when it appeared, actually attracted much media attention. It was on television news. It was carried by wire services. It was cited at conferences. It was American Medical News, American Medical Association's Medical News of the Week. But did its appearance stimulate other studies on healthcare environments? I hoped it would, but it didn't at first. At least not for some years. As an indication of this, in 1990, I was asked to speak at the National Symposium, specifically on the topic of surveying research concerning the effects of healthcare design on clinical outcomes. I said, sure, accepted, expected to find studies, went to the Texas A&M Library, dug for a couple of weeks, and found very little, less than a dozen studies. But finally, by the mid-90s, more studies began to appear. And here, the importance and the key role played by the Center of Health Design for Health Design cannot be overstated, cannot be overemphasized. The annual conferences at that time, like now, always featured new research. And the center's research committee from the earliest years, which later became the Research Coalition, funded some noteworthy studies. And later in the year 2000, when the Pebble Project was launched, that created scores of studies emanating from the member hospitals. In the late 90s, the center took something of a calculated risk and funded a team at Johns Hopkins Medical School to review the research literature. They were asked to be objective, impartial. They found, to our pleasant surprise, about 80 strong studies. The report lauded this embryonic field as having much potential. It helped, in my opinion, to attract interest in healthcare design in the medical research community. There were other factors also at about the same time, generating more interest among researchers, especially in medicine. One was the increasing importance internationally throughout medicine, medical education, of mind-body medicine. Also, by the 90s, healthcare providers in the US were routinely surveying patient satisfaction, and there was much data that had made it crystal clear to C-suites that certain design factors, such as single rooms, had large effects on satisfaction. And then a very powerful set of forces motivating much more research emerged in the late 90s. These were threats to patient safety. Dangers posed, for example, by antibiotic-resistant infection and medical errors. The IOM issued its famous report on medical errors, and the media began to portray hospitals as risky, even dangerous places. By 2004, the amount of quality research had clearly grown. That was the date of the first comprehensive review. It was perhaps a couple hundred good studies. By 2008, the last time a really comprehensive review was done, I led that study. It was a project collaboration between Texas A&M and Georgia Tech, and I had about 2,000 research articles references on my computer. Today in 2015, the number of quality peer-reviewed articles is certainly far larger, perhaps running to a few thousand. Apart from increased quantity, I'm particularly encouraged by what I think is a clear pattern of improving quality. But many gaps clearly remain in research, in our research knowledge. There is still a long way to go. Has the amount of research evidence grown to the point where research knowledge, or will it grow to the point? It's certainly growing faster now, much faster. Will it ever grow to the point where one day I think it might dominate somehow most design decisions in healthcare projects? I don't think so at all. And if we could have the yes. Here is a diagram inspired largely by Kirk Hamilton at Texas A&M in a discussion in Sweden 2 years ago, and with some input from my Swedish colleagues. This shows in a simple way the types of general knowledge needed to design a complex modern hospital. By far, the most of the knowledge required remains the traditional bodies of knowledge, best technical practice, and the art of architecture, the problem solving, the intuition, the creativity, the spatial planning, and so on. Evidence-based design is growing, but it remains relatively small. However, I think it's worth emphasizing that though the amount of research is relatively small, it carries weight with decision makers. That's because most of the EB knowledge is actually of quite good quality, and most of it relates to priority issues such as patient safety, and many of the studies and findings can be linked directly to cost savings and to a strong business case for better design. So, no, there's no way I think that EBD will ever take over the whole process, no way at all. But EBD is there, it's growing, it's alive, and can empower and inform the creativity of designers using other traditional knowledge bases. And let me close by saying again how greatly honored and pleased I am to receive the Changemaker Award.
I've been introduced.
Okay.
And now I'd like to introduce Kirk Hamilton, a fellow of the Center for Health Systems and Design and a professor of architecture at Texas A&M University in College Station, Texas, who is not only a longtime friend of Roger's, but has worked closely with him through the years. Maybe we'll hear just how far the world has come since that first documented study of viewing nature.
Congratulations, Roger.
Thank you very much. I'm going to...
So you're going to forgive us because both of us are struggling with a sore throat and so on. So I, you know, have to say that a huge number of people in this room have considered you a hero for a long, long time, and that includes me.
Thank you very much. It's an honor.
I know that my own personal career would certainly not have taken the same trajectory as it has without your inspiration and without your generous mentorship. So thanks, Roger.
And thank you, Kirk, for all your mentorship all those years and your great projects when you were in practice.
So I know that you gave them the photographs that we saw. I can't believe the image of you looking like one of the Beatles. Somebody told me it was George Harrison.
But there's got to be a story behind you ending up at the University of Michigan. I think there's a story associated with some beautiful Swedish woman, and I think there's a travel around the world in a Volkswagen like a couple of hippies. What's all about that?
Okay. I grew up in southeastern Michigan, out in a town outside of Detroit, and went to undergraduate at the University of Michigan and majored in economics, international economics. And after my first 4-year degree, I got a job, and it was a good job, and I made a good salary, and I saved much of it, and quit at the end of a year, and went off to Europe and traveled for several months, and that was really a formative experience. And somewhere in Europe, sitting in some hill town or some alpine valley, I had this naive epiphany that idealistic, very naive epiphany that somehow I wanted to have a career where I focused on environmental aesthetics, on beauty. Beauty in nature, beauty in cities, beauty in architecture.
And that's where we lost the economist?
That's where you lost the economist. That's where I lost the interest in economics and a business career, actually. And in my travels, I ended up in Scandinavia for the summer and met this absolutely wonderful Swedish girl. And we ended up spending the summer together driving in the Norwegian fjords in her little red Volkswagen Beetle. The story is objectively romantic.
It certainly is. It certainly is.
And the next year we were married, and somehow, as a Swedish student, she'd finished a degree there. She was accepted at the University of Michigan, so we lived together in Ann Arbor as students.
Yeah. And then it seems that you ended up at the University of Delaware, and that's where, as a young assistant professor, you produced this earth-shattering report, The View from a Window Study. At one time, you told me that it was sort of a perfect example of a natural experiment. You want to say a little more about that?
I went to the University of Delaware and taught environment behavior courses, something like social factors and design, in the social science program. There were no design schools at Delaware. And I began doing research on environmental aesthetics. And by the late 70s, really, had generated the first findings showing that looking at nature could effectively reduce stress, including physiological stress, evident, for example, in the brain or in blood pressure. At the time, frankly, I had no practical purposes of the uses in mind. I was a scientist doing basic research. But by the early 80s, I started asking myself, is there some practical use for this? The nature stress reduction effect was consistent and rather large. So I asked myself, where's a situation in the real world where stress is a very important problem and where exposure to nature might be particularly beneficial, even healthful? And at this point, I could remember only too well my own childhood experiences being in hospitals and imprisoned in a bed and looking out, usually at a bad window view. So I conceived the window view study and designed the study and obtained funding. I couldn't find funding except from the US Forest Service. They had an urban forestry research program, and they said, yeah, we're interested in the benefits of nature in cities, so they funded it. Getting back to your real question, how it was a kind of perfect experiment, a big challenge was to find a hospital for the study that had exactly the right combination of architectural conditions. And to do that was not easy. It took a year. And I toured 35 hospitals in the Mid-Atlantic region and finally identified Paoli Memorial Hospital in West Philadelphia as the study hospital. that had perfect conditions. There were corridors that where the patient rooms were exactly the same, all on one side of the hallway. The staff serving the patients were the same. The patients were assigned to rooms in an almost randomized way, except the difference was that half the patient rooms looked out onto a brick wall and half look out onto trees, and that made the study possible.
I'll bet. So not long after that, you made a transition to Texas A&M University. You were the founder of their active Center for Health Systems and Design. And it seems like during that period, your research was really about art and noise. Wasn't most of it related somehow to stress in healthcare?
Okay, let me begin by talking about Texas A&M. That was, I moved to Texas A&M from the East Coast in 1988, and that was critically important for my development. I became an architecture professor. My wife thought it was a constructive way to have a midlife crisis. I actually landed in the dean's office and was there for 9 years. And from the get-go, I began meeting regularly with principals from major multidisciplinary design firms, including large firms that were major players in healthcare. And I learned a lot talking to the practitioners. I learned about the business of healthcare. And some of those folks are here in the audience today, such as Ron Skaggs from that time, HKS. I also began teaching, co-teaching Design Studio. And that was very important for my learning. Trained as a researcher, now I learned about how designers think, solve problems, and create. And that became important context for me in tailoring my research for the design audiences I was increasingly addressing. And it was relatively easy to start a healthcare critical mass program at Texas A&M, and that was because the path had already been well plowed by George Mann, who had, Professor George Mann came to Texas A&M in the 1960s. He's still at Texas A&M. I don't know if George is here today.
He's in his 49th year of teaching at A&M.
So, unbelievable, the Energizer Bunny. So the courses were on the books, the precedents were there, and that made it easy. Did I do research on stress? Yes. In 1990, I published a paper called A Theory of Supportive Healthcare Design that I think broke ground at the time by proposing and identifying stress as a key pathway or mechanism by which healthcare design can improve clinical outcomes. And the paper also identified certain general design strategies that were kind of designer friendly for reducing stress and improving outcomes, designing to foster control, foster access to social support, and one category I created, pleasant or positive distractions. It's good to know, finally, there's some evidence empirically that the theory actually works and actually does have positive effects.
Well, that was a theory that really influenced a large number of us, me included.
It seemed to address a vacuum. It began to be quickly used by designers. And within a decade, I would receive, almost once a month, seemingly, a design brief or set of specifications for a large hospital, say in Europe or North America or Singapore, Australia. And it would be from the development office. And they would say, we just wanted you to know that we've featured your theory of supportive design in the design vision, goals, and requirements. So it went on to influence hospital design to a large degree.
So I'm going to blame you for getting me to Texas A&M. I think I had a pretty decent job. But you eventually,
you certainly did.
You eventually convinced me to make the shift after I had done my master's degree, and I'll never forget a quote. I asked Roger, as he was convincing me to join the faculty, I said, I think I know what this tenure thing is all about, but would you please really explain it to me? And Roger said to me, I'll never forget it, he said, if you are cognitively able to teach the class and someone can wheel you in there, you have a job.
If you've got tenure.
Well, based on his advice, I only went there with tenure on arrival. So during that same sort of period, you spent many years on the board of the Center for Health Design, a nonprofit in California. That may be, I think, where we first spent time together. Tell us a bit how the Center for Health Design influenced your path.
A great deal, and the short answer is, I joined the board from the beginning in the early 90s, and from the beginning, it was an incredibly rich learning experience for me. There were wonderful people on the board from diverse areas, with different backgrounds. People like Russ Coyle, a healthcare futurist, Jane Malkin, who's still affiliated with the center, the great architect and stalwart patron of the Healing Environments movement, Derek Parker, and others. It was a special learning experience. And the center was very small and embryonic, but the board and staff were, I think, passionate. We had a sense that the center's mission, and it remains today, was a noble cause.
Yeah.
We're going to improve things. I served on the research committee and in other capacities for many, many years. So it influenced me in many ways. I think one key reason for the center's success, particularly in the first decade, was that from the beginning, the board of directors was very multidisciplinary. There were designers, there were researchers, a healthcare futurist, a facility manager, a clinician, always at least one healthcare hospital CEO, a patient safety person. It was quite a mix. And people served for longer terms at that time, and a certain chemistry could develop that sometimes was creative. For example, the Pebble Project grew exactly out of that chemistry in year 2000. It was sort of a board-up initiative. The Fable Hospital concept, board members hanging around who become good friends from different fields. Len Berry, our colleague and friend from Texas A&M in business school. Derek Parker, and you played a very key role, Kirk, in that may have originated the Fable Hospital concept. Blair Sadler from San Diego Children's. And that's an able group, creative group, and they wrote a sequence of articles that was very influential in helping to make the business case for better healthcare buildings and show return on investment for evidence-based design.
So for the record, Derek Parker really was the originator of the fable. But Derek tells the story, and I recall it. We were having a drink the night before he was to present in Orlando. It was in one of those fancy Swan hotels or something like that. And I was regaling him with my recent stuff from my graduate degree. I was currently in a master's program at the time, and I was fascinated that I had just learned that all the facts that I had depended on my whole career to be the rational guy, the logical guy, were useless if the client had a different mindset, and that the only way you could change the mindset was through emotion. So I was telling him I had learned so much about storytelling. Well, that night, Derek trashed his speech that was planned for the next morning, and he basically began a whole new presentation based on telling the story. And afterwards, he came to us and said, we have to tell the story of what became the Fable Hospital. It's an interesting time. So along those years, you started actually doing your research in Sweden. You were there in the summers and other times?
Yeah, I started very early in the 70s as an assistant professor. And initially, it was simply because my wife was Swedish. And then we had two sons. And my wife would speak Swedish to them when I wasn't in the room. And we'd spend summers in Sweden with
grandparents. How is your Swedish?
It's workable. It's debatable. There are a couple Swedes here who would know, have a more critical view. I can understand the TV news, put it that way. But I quickly learned that the Swedish research establishment is really world class. They have fewer researchers, but they're very, very good. And I was able to secure research funding from the Swedish government on multiple occasions to support myself and my family to go abroad and spend years, a year at a time, at different Swedish universities where I worked with wonderful researchers from different fields. And this really empowered me. For example, in the late 70s, I worked with an environmental psychologist in the School of Architecture at Lund. His name was Richard Kuhler, and he had the first laboratory for physiological psychology in an architecture school. And that's where I did the first physiological monitoring studies. And so it's been really helpful. And currently, down to present, at Chalmers University, I have superb colleagues, people like Peter Frost and Stefan Lundén, Sten Grönmark, and many others.
Yeah. So some of the studies that came out of that are things like the time it takes for the body to recover from stress after having viewed nature. Were those some of the studies?
Yeah, and also what we haven't talked about is less relevant to healthcare, but to nature theory is biophilia theory. And I learned a lot from working with colleagues in Sweden that contributed to my contributions in biophilia.
So, Roger, you're particularly well known for some of these literature review summaries. Some of us, with a tongue in cheek, basically think of some of your work as being sort of the evidence-based design Bible. I think the Old Testament was the 2003 version, and then we at HERD published your 2008 study, the one you mentioned from the podium with Georgia Tech folks. We think of that as the New Testament. Do you think it's time to have another update of the literature?
Absolutely. It's past time. As I said in my opening comments, there's a lot of new research. I think research is growing at an increasing rate. And there is, I strongly feel, a big need for a new, careful, systematic, comprehensive review. A systematic review looks at hundreds of studies and therefore can detect patterns across studies where findings are stronger, well-established, other areas where they're weaker, the findings are more problematic, or there's just a lack of research. And by looking across all this research, it's sometimes possible in a systematic review to infer new things. You get this deeper level of understanding, but also some new inferences. For example, it's possible occasionally to identify potentially effective new design approaches. So there is really a need. It would take a team, a dedicated team, of skilled, qualified researchers. It would take at least 2 years and a sizable grant. And I'm not volunteering here to lead the next comprehensive review.
Well, speaking of the next generation, you've talked about how much the research is increasing and how much more is now being produced. Maybe you could share some thoughts about the future of the environmental research that's going to relate to health and healthcare?
I think there's a lot of emerging topics. I'll give a couple of examples, a few examples. It reflects just my own experience and knowledge, probably neglect several. One is, in the last year or two, we're seeing the first cluster of good studies showing that informed evidence-based design can substantially reduce aggressive behavior and physical violence. And I think those studies are potentially very important because aggressive behavior and physical violence is a key patient safety problem, it's a key staff safety problem, and it's a key cost in medicine. And new findings would add something of a new repertoire in designing psychiatric facilities or potentially emergency departments where violence can be a problem. I think we're beginning to see, as another example, the embryonic beginning of something like an evidence-based design or an environmental psychology for operating theaters. And those operating theaters are really complicated spaces. They're small, intense footprints where a lot happens, and they're a microcosm of so much. And we know really very little from an evidence-based design standpoint about them, except from the standpoint of air quality and so on. But that's a promising area, and we're beginning to see a few studies, particularly in Sweden, on other high-tech healthcare environments. Another example, we're beginning to see a few game-changing studies that are randomized control studies done by medical researchers where the intervention is a carefully integrated cluster of, on the one hand, design changes, and on the other, changes in care processes. And then what's examined is the effect on outcomes compared to the previous or alternative tradition.
So the intervention is a bundle.
It's a bundle intervention. Yeah. And those have been big effects. And the research, for example, on neonatal intensive care has been a game changer internationally, shortening length of stay for level three babies in the most critical level by 10 full days, saving money galore, and saving lives.
So let me change the topic a little bit. We've seen a couple of photographs of you being involved with advising governments around the world. Tell us what you have been telling them and what they did about it.
Something over 10 years ago, I began to be asked by governments in other countries to serve as an advisor on evidence-based design, sometimes for large individual hospital projects and increasingly for programs of construction. I think the longest appointment was association was with the British National Health Service. It really began in 2004 and ended in early 2007. In that case, my wife and I moved to London, and I took leave from Texas A&M for a couple of years. Now, in these advisory roles, I never really had a position with any actual power or authority. But I was always in a position where I had the ear of the leadership, and sometimes the highest level of government. For example, the Prime Minister's healthcare advisor, or the health minister. So I learned that it really was possible to have influence if my arguments were good and the evidence was good. But I also learned quickly that it was naive for me to expect an open-arm reception for change. There would always be resistance to change, always. It varies from country to country, by the way, and it's always there in sort of Medical Nursing Association, some of them, not others. It's an interesting side, you know, to what degree they vary between different countries. Some are more receptive to change than others. But I had to develop a tactic that would break through this and kick the door open to enable real changes, particularly in the patient care environment. And my tactic was to focus on single rooms, specifically on sharply increasing the proportion of single rooms. And I knew that by making arguments for single rooms, I would immediately have support from the whole infection control community, which is influential. Sure. They all got on board, endorsed them, and for most of the patient safety community. It was also a way of getting on this bandwagon the various patient associations, former patients and so on, who sometimes felt disenfranchised in national health systems. So in this way, it proved possible to affect change, and affect change rather quickly. And there were other things happening as well in the mid-2000s. For example, antibiotic-resistant infection, morbidity, and mortality was rising very sharply in Europe, in Australia, as well as North America. And in other countries outside the US, healthcare data is rather more transparently available. So the press, for example, could get a hold of the data and really put heat on politicians. And I just very pragmatically exploited that.
So you told me at one point about the degree of change in the number of single rooms from one place to...
When I began to take the NHS in England, for example, when I began coming regularly in 2004, it was typical for a new PFI, big, costly hospital for a few hundred million pounds, to have 15% or 20% single rooms. And the highest number at the time was about 30%. By the time I left at the end of 2006, the minimum was 80% single rooms with private toilets. And the first specs were out for the first hospitals with 100% single bedrooms.
That's a remarkable change in a short period of time.
I was pleased with that.
So Roger, you've been a faculty member, a teacher, and a researcher for a long time. Do you have some quick advice for educators and students that might be in the group?
Of course. We've talked about this at Texas A&M endlessly. First, I think it's very important to teach evidence-based design in more design schools, and not enough schools offer it at present. And I believe strongly that offering one class is not nearly enough. There ought to be multiple classes. And to take the sort of Texas A&M model at the graduate level, I taught a seminar or a small lecture format course every semester. It was required for our healthcare design students that surveyed evidence-based design key findings and certain key topic areas like patient safety. So by the end of the class, students could read and interpret a research article and even perhaps have a meaningful conversation with a patient safety clinician from a potential client. But it's also extremely important to infuse evidence-based design into multiple design studios where the projects focus on healthcare projects. And I think it's very important, sort of following your writings for years and your recommendations, that students learn to make hypotheses explicitly. The idea that if they use this cluster and a thoughtful way of design features, then they can explain with a reasonable, plausible explanation why those design factors should achieve some intended consequence. So I know we used to require students to annotate their projects to show what features of the room would be healing in what specific ways, for example, a patient room.
I still do that with my students.
And enable students to develop more skills to read articles. They'll find that the article is never directly relevant to their particular design project, but to read the article, extract the implications of the findings, and then creatively integrate that knowledge and think about how it applies to their particular project.
Yeah, it's always about interpretation of the evidence, right? Yeah, so nobody's ever done a nice scientific study of a building that has yet to be built, right? So it's always interpretation of the impact on the project that's on the designer's desk.
And I always thought that if students could be clear in explaining why these design features, for example, in a patient room, could be reasonably expected to help lessen infection or help reduce medical errors, as examples. And if they could then say that when they're presenting to a client, the client was likely to be impressed, and the student in practice might be a bit more likely to win work.
So, Roger, the clock is ticking. What do you feel has been your most significant achievement? As you look back, what do you see as the successes and disappointments about the introduction of evidence-based design?
I'll start with what I think are my achievements.
And we're hoping for a quick answer here.
All right. First, work on nature, stress reduction effects, and health-related effects more generally, and biophilia theory, which, again, I haven't talked about. A second area would be my research and theory development relating to stress and identifying stress as a key pathway by which design features can affect clinical outcomes and identifying design measures for reducing stress. And I'll list a final third one, and this might come as a surprise. I was an early advocate for single bedrooms, going back well over 10 years. And was able to put together a multifaceted argument and get a fair amount of data that over time became increasingly convincing as more data appeared. And I think that in some practical, pragmatic, short-term applied sense, that's my contribution that in some way has actually save the most lives in hospitals internationally.
That's been very special. I can remember when we tried to convince people to have single rooms on the basis of dignity and privacy for the patient and not really based on what you later gave us the permission to use. So, Roger, I want to thank you for sharing with us. This has been really special for me. I'm very proud of you. So Roger Ulrich has dramatically and permanently changed the whole world of health and healthcare design. He's done that ever since his groundbreaking study in 1984. He's given us as designers and practitioners ammunition to be credible in the world of science with physicians and nurses, in the world of the economics of healthcare administration and so forth. We were finally able to contend with some design features that were not simply subjective aesthetic choices, ego-driven. We were able to escape the blame of being impractical artist types. It was Roger who gave us the power to begin to work as rational, research-informed decision makers who could make meaningful choices to improve the health, welfare, experience, and quality of life for everyone who found themselves in health facilities or who worked there. So, Roger, thank you for all you have done. Please join me in another round of applause for our changemaker, Dr. Roger Ulrich.
Thank you. Thank you. Should I come there? Thank you.
I miss you, Roger. I love listening to you lecture. So thank you, Roger and Kirk. Finally, I'd like to congratulate all the winners. You're all winners. Thank you for being here. Enjoy the rest of your day.
Can you feel it? Now it's coming back. We can steal it. If we bridge this gap, I can see you through the curtains of the waterfall. When I lost